Alex, I'm having a really hard time getting one of our teams to buy into CI/CD. They've stated they're too busy and don't see a value in automating because they don't release often. How would you describe the value of CI/CD in their circumstance and convince this team that it is worth the investment of resources?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And that one's tough because there is no standard answer to it. But I will share an anecdote. Basically, I think this is one from one of our first ever Buildmaster services. This had to be like, years and years and years ago. And we were sort of a little bit more service oriented than when we were, more product oriented. So basically, I was the guy in charge of helping their internal team roll out, we didn't call it CI/CD in those days, but automation across their accounts. And we had a team that had just, they had this really interesting concept. I forget which specific thing they were doing, but I remember going to those meetings and it was hostile. They literally didn't see the value of automation. And it was fascinating to sit in those conversations and frustrating at the same time. Well, if we automate this, how will we know that there's an error that occurs? I believe this. A release manager of that team, what she said was, currently my manual process, if I notice any problem in it, I can immediately address it. If we put this in Buildmaster and now I hit a button and then my script crashes halfway through, I cannot quickly adapt it. I cannot quickly fix it. This just isn't, this is just going to cause more problems and more pain than it's going to solve. In addition, I mean, this is my job. I don't really understand why are you trying to make my job more efficient? My script is really good. I run it. If there's a problem, crashes. So ultimately, where I learned from this is that there was no amount of really convincing that I could do to really sell her on automation. And I'm seeing this in the same sort of theme here, right? It's that same sort of thing. Like the excuse is far too busy. There's no value. I don't see the point. I don't see the purpose. But I think that this is just one of those big organizational things. Where I think that a lot of this isn't the answer to this wasn't obvious. And I think in this case, it's not obvious either. It's really addressing what their underlying concern is. In her case, where I think that this release manager was struggling with is her value to the organization was her ability to release the software. And as soon as we took that out of her hands, what she felt is that the value that she could provide, which she was the one who ran the script, she was the script master, whatever you want to call it. The value that she provided the organization would be taken away as soon as we put that into Buildmaster. So when we look into a case like this, how do you describe the value of CI/CD? There's tons of things in that. You could show them your internal case studies and say, look, we reduced the deploy time from this to this. Their excuse, their answer will be, well, who cares? We only release every 6 months. Why do we need to go from a 2-day release cycle to a 2-minute release cycle? One of the things that I maybe a long time ago might have said is, well, why are you releasing every 6 months? Why don't you release every 1 month instead? Wouldn't that be a better value to their customers? That introducing that conversation early on just makes them intimidated. Like, well, there's no way we could do that because we have a 6-month release cycle. So the ultimate answer to this is really it's less about demonstrating value because their mind, especially on the individual contributor on the execution level, which is what this team, I'm getting the impression from this team here, is that at the end of the day, they're basically, I don't want to say afraid, they're very hesitant to change the way that things are because it will add undue risk to them. So they don't understand CI/CD. They're not looking for the value, but at the end of the day, what's their motivation? Like, why should they do it? What benefit do they get? Not the value to the organization. What benefit do they personally get by risking automating some of their current job, accelerating the releases? So a lot of it just comes down to trying to get some of those underlying answers. In this particular case, so going back to that anecdote that I had, I hate to say it, but I mean, it took prying it from their hands, from her hands, to really get that thing to happen. And in it was unfortunate that we just had to sort of really go above her to say, look, this is the direction that the organization is going. I had that power because I was essentially the CTO's proxy, right? If you're just on the release engineering team and that's a sort of a lateral relationship, you're not going to. So I think all you can do is sort of gather metrics on all the other teams. How are they doing? As soon as that team realizes that they're not the early adopters, that's fine. They're not the mid-stage adopters,
yeah,
that's fine. But at some point, if they don't see the value, your job isn't convincing them the value. At some point, you just have to say, sorry, guys. And this is the CTO. It's the way this is the way we're moving. So
yeah,
long-winded answer, but it's a lot more.
If I'm hearing you correctly, and we have another one of the other pre-submitted questions, has that same, I'm trying to persuade peers, not rule with an iron fist. A lot of it comes down to without having to rule with an iron fist, you basically have the option, if I'm hearing you correctly, of kind of saying, you might not be aware of this, but your team's appearance is starting to be noticeable to others in a not positive way. So you might want to do some, maybe call it self-image management on a team level, obviously. Is that kind of what you're saying?
It's and this is where in the DevOps, you know, you're hammered with DevOps is tools, but also culture. This is that culture change that everyone, it takes a while. Like people are like, well, okay, we just installed Buildmaster and now we have CI/CD. Well, no, you got to change the culture. So exactly, I mean, whether you're that direct about it, but honestly, I mean, what I've seen, particularly in implementations of Buildmaster, is you have team, everyone's starting to buy in, because here's what happens. The reason that they do this is because it makes their lives easier. Like the value's inherent. They see it, they read the brochure. The brochure, I put that up because that's sort of the internal sales
right
pitch. But like, I mean, what ends up happening is they see this value and they elect to do it inherently. You know, the public shaming happens naturally through the metric-driven, goal-driven thing. When you can
right
start seeing every other team's things, when everyone else, as an example, is using, if everyone else in the organization is using Semver, except for this one team, or semantic versioning
yeah
for this one team, now it's like, oh, great, we understand how everyone's, oh, except for that team. Okay, hold on. They're special. So eventually they will start realizing that they're the problem. You know, that's what I've heard is a really nice way to do that. But unfortunately, that takes years. So
yeah,
you almost have to, in the case of Buildmaster, I've seen and recommended folks do this pattern. So Buildmaster gets you a pipeline. So that's the most important thing, is that pipeline visualization, right? Integration test, prod, whatever. Just put in a manual action that all they have to do is just, it sends them an email and then says, perform your manual steps. What this does is it very quickly shows them that, you know, because you need that universal pipeline so that everyone can see status. That's how you give it. But force them to do it the manual, which you're already doing. They're responding to emails, but use Buildmaster to email them to do things. So eventually they will, cave is not the word I want to use, but they'll eventually see the value and also realize that they're the ones causing the problems for everyone else. And that's a big thing that causes change for almost everyone. Once they realize they're actually the problem, they're the pain point for everybody else, it's a very quick way for people to change.
Yeah, they get a taste of the convenience and then say, what if we delve a little bit further into it?
Yeah.
What if we do just a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit, oh, okay, I'm starting to understand it. And I wasn't forced or coerced.
Yeah. Forcing change is tough, but once they, you know, for those remaining teams who are like, we can't do automation, it's a pain, fine, let them realize, make it known, not in a mean way, but just as long as you have metrics, measurements, visibility in place, I mean, they'll quickly start seeing that they're actually the problem.
And this kind of reminds me, if I'm correct, Jody Dorchester's talk about automation in government at InedoCon. They basically, you know, it was very Canadian. They gave teams the option of who wanted to be kind of the pilot teams. Very opt-in, and really, once the example started showing the benefits for themselves, they found that more and more teams wanted to step up, if that makes sense.
That was a really good model of doing it.
Very uncoercive.
And I think giving a lot of that, and that's a great way to do it. And that's sort of it, is you make it optional for the longest time. And then as soon as you get to that last chunk of teams, you know, the last 10, 20, I don't know, bottom of 20 percentile, they're going to need a little bit more prodding. And that was a good one. So I definitely recommend that talk to a lot of folks.
Yeah, that was Jody Dorchester's talk at InedoCon, inedocon.inedo.com, along with all the other talks.